Okay, kids, come on, here we go. Here we go, line up. Ho, hat-choo, hat-choo. Yeah, good, good. Well, it's nice to see you. Tell me, when is the last time you all had a physical?
You've got to be kidding. We are all superheroes. We don't need to take a physical.
Oh, good, Marvin. Then we'll start with you. Now, open your mouth. Open. And say Shazam. Didn't your mama ever tell you not to talk with your mouth filled? Tell you what, let's check your muscles. Oh, you got good muscle tone. That's good. That's good. Ah, Flash. I tell you what, give me your hand. I want to check your pulse. Boom, diggity, boom, diggity, boom, chiggity, boom. That was voluptuous going there. 604, that's normal. Now, I want you to race a mile. Hold on. Ready? Okay, go. Okay, forget it. I haven't got time to race with you.
I'm telling you, I haven't seen people dressed like this since I had lunch at Alice Cooper's house. And we're about to see our heroes roasted and toasted by their arch enemies and by other super villains.
To the doomsday device, correct?
Where is this doomsday device?
I don't know, but we must find it.
We wanted to make sure it just wasn't a physical attraction.
If you think the Hawkman's so tough, let him walk through Harlem with them wings on. By the time he got to Lenox Avenue, he'd be Kentucky Fried.
Everybody okay?
Later, make house calls. You know what I mean?
I'm delighted to be here tonight with all my favorite superheroes.
Brightest day, the darkest night.
The world's fastest man.
Unless you're good at removing arrows.
Where can I find a psychiatrist out here?
Holy Amazon!
The Batmobile is terrible!
September 1973, Hanna-Barbera debuted their new Super Friends cartoon. It was basically an adaptation of DC's Justice League of America, but the title Super Friends sounds so much more inviting to the young tykes the show was aimed at. Here you got to see all the major DC guns working together. The show became a highlight for fans on Saturday mornings. Back in the dark ages, before DVDs, DVRs, or the internet, if kids wanted to watch their favorite cartoons, they would have to wake up early Saturday mornings, tune the tube to one of the few channels there were, and sit and watch them live. There really was no way around it. Back in the day, on a Saturday morning, you could pretty much be guaranteed that if a house had a little kid in it, that kid would be awake watching their favorite cartoons. Maybe that's one of the reasons those old cartoons are so fondly remembered by that generation. You actually had to do some work to watch that stuff. I don't think Saturday mornings are as big a deal as what they used to be for kids. So anyway, the Super Friends show did some morphing along its run, and one of the more notable versions of it was Challenge of the Super Friends. This was where even more superheroes showed up, and they were faced with the Legion of Doom, the evil villains who pool all their resources together in never-ending attempts to conquer the world. So having produced some of the most popular cartoons during its time, Hanna-Barbera attempted to branch into the live-action format. So in 1979, Legends of the Superheroes aired, which would be sort of a real-world version of a Challenge of the Super Friends show, and provide the same fun and thrills to fans in the evening. So announcer Gary Owens gives us our roster of heroes, and it's not a bad lineup. The most notable absences are Superman and Wonder Woman. And my guess is since those characters were at the time being used in actual successful productions, they had to miss out on this one. Too bad for them. The biggest casting coup in these is the return of Adam West and Burt Ward as the dynamic duo, along with Frank Gorshin as the Riddler in one episode. It's been over 10 years since the Batman show ended, and Burt and Frank look a a little bit heavier than when we last saw them. Adam surprisingly looks exactly the same, like no time has passed. There is a decent number of DC heroes and villains to make you perk up your ears, some making their first live-action appearance and some their only one. We're probably never going to see this cast of characters again all starring together in another live-action project. Only two episodes were produced, and that's probably too many. It's an attempted comedy action show done in a variety show format, a format that was very popular at the time. By now, just by the looks of things, you're probably getting a good idea of the quality of this thing. Yeah, this is a really weird experience. The first episode is simply entitled The Challenge. After the thrilling introductions to the characters, we're taken to the villain's hideout where they have their own roll call and reveal their evil scheme. Listen, the plot isn't really worth going over. Basically, a doomsday device is going to go off in an hour and will kill everyone on the planet, except them. But they will leave the superheroes clues that will trick them into thinking that they can actually stop the device from going off. Yeah, I don't know. Why would you even tell them about the doomsday device in the first place? I mean, just have it go off and don't tell anyone about it. Success. There's no logic to any of this. It's for little kids. Little kids that can't reason yet. We cut to the Hall of Heroes. Actually, it's the same set, only redressed, where all the superheroes are honoring retired man. See, he's an old superhero, and he's retired, and he's cranky, and he's out of shape, and just really old, and forget it. They receive their first clues about the doomsday device, and the action then starts.
Superheroes, disperse!
Our heroes race around, mainly to a gas station and in the woods, trying to find the doomsday device. It's all pretty bad. The superheroes get entangled in these silly tricks of the villains, and there's really not a laugh to be had, which is probably why they use the laugh track during the show. There are seemingly random scenes consisting of Batman and Robin at a used car lot, the Riddler disguised as a psychiatrist, some tricked-out lemonade, a pair of surprised-looking picnickers, Marcia Warfield in a phone booth, Sinestro dressed as a gypsy, Hawkman and Black Canary being captured by Solomon Grundy, Batman and Robin crashing into a lake, all before the dramatic climax of a jet ski chase and a final fight at the villain's lair. Yeah, this is all pretty bad. I mean, even for a low-budget production, this all looks pretty cheap. And even for a wacky variety special, this is off the charts. The comedy is non-existent. Every bit is just awkward and slowly dies out before we're on to the next scene. The cast of superheroes isn't bad, but the bulk of screen time goes to Batman and Robin, followed by Captain Marvel and Green Lantern. They all have extended, allegedly funny scenes. Hawkman mainly walks around. I don't think the makers of this would have even attempted to try to give him a flying scene. Flash zips around a bit with a bad camera stop effect. Huntress and Black Canary don't do much and are mainly here for eye candy. That's one thing the show succeeds in. There's a lot of stuff that I could go on about, like why is Green Lantern zapping himself with his power ring? The Batmobile makes an appearance, but maybe it's me, but something looks off about it for some reason. It looks like it's cardboard or there's a cover over it or something. I don't think it's the real Batmobile. Stunts, choreography, special effects, they either forgot about them or they used the bargain basement kind. I could forgive the thing for not being the most polished looking production if there was some other kind of entertainment value to it, like if it was funny or creative or in any way entertaining, but it's just not. At certain points I started to wonder if this was just all improv, like the actors were just making up the story as they went along. Again, there's a lot of characters here, done badly, but still. It is interesting to see how they all look, and I have to say that using a Halloween costume kind of curve, the costumes aren't terrible. I mean, you can tell who everyone is. I mean, if you walked into a costume party wearing one of these, you would be a hit. Obviously, these would look way too silly and low rent for an actual serious production. It looks like Hawkman's beak is cardboard, And for some reason, Adam West's cowl is untucked, which is kind of off-putting. Kind of makes him look like he's supposed to be Iguana Man. But generally, all the costumes adhere pretty closely to the comic book characters. Unfortunately, what might look good in the comic pages doesn't always translate really well to real life. The girls both look pretty good. You know, showing off cleavage and legs tends to do that for hot women. But for a goof, little kids would probably get a kick out of these colorful, shiny costumes. Like, if these guys were walking around an amusement park, they probably would be pretty busy posing for pictures with kids.
The one of the worst catastrophes in the world. Oh, the humanity. I can't talk, ladies and gentlemen.